Hello, and welcome to this video resource from the Connection Church, where you will experience a casual place with serious faith. We invite you to come check it out for yourself this Sunday morning. Visit our website, theconnectionchurch.org, for service times and location. Now, get ready to hear another fun and practical message about how you can get connected with God and the people around you.
Epic. So I'm a proud graduate of the University of Texas, Hook'em Horns, but my heart belongs in Starkville, Mississippi with the Mississippi State Bulldogs because that's where I'm originally from, and that's where my dad went to school. So Friday night, we watched the last 17.6 seconds of regulation, and we were just going nuts at my house, and then watching overtime and watching the Mississippi State women beat UConn and end their 111-game winning streak was one of the most amazing upsets I've ever seen, and I would argue of all time. So y'all are welcome. There's plenty of room on the bandwagon. Game starts at 5 tonight. I can't remember what channel it's on, ESPN, I think. But the thing about underdogs is that we see a little bit of ourselves in them, right? We see that scrappy, overachieving group going up against the talent, going up against the mighty giants. And when they win, it just makes us feel good, right? That's why March Madness is so much fun, because you see stuff like that and it's out of the ordinary. And it gives us just a little glimmer of hope that maybe that can be us too. But you know, there's this little voice in my head sometimes when I see that and I start thinking, maybe that could be me. And that little voice says, no, no, you're not enough to ever be that. We're going to continue our series on direct messages from God today. And the church that we're going to take a look at is the church in Philadelphia. That's not Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. That's Philadelphia in Asia. And I think that there might have been something going on in the church in Philadelphia that had them feeling like they were underdogs too. So I want to go to our text for today. It's Revelation chapter 3. It's verses 7 through 13, and if you brought your Bible, feel free to open it up and read along, but we're going to have the verses up, I think, actually there. Yeah, they're already there. I'll stop talking and start reading. Write this letter to the angel of the church in Philadelphia. This is the message from the one who is holy and true, the one who has the key of David. What he opens, no one can close, and what he closes, no one can open. I know all the things you do, and I've opened a door for you that no one can close. You have little strength, yet you obeyed my word and did not deny me. Look, I will force those who belong to Satan's synagogue, those liars who say they are Jews but are not, to come and bow down at your feet. They will acknowledge that you are the ones that I love. Because you have obeyed my command to persevere, I will protect you from the great time of testing that will come upon the whole world to test those who belong to this world. I am coming soon. Hold on to what you have so that no one will take away your crown. All who are victorious will become pillars in the temple of my God, and they will never have to leave it. And I will write on them the name of my God, and they will be citizens in the city of my God, the new Jerusalem that comes down from heaven from my God. And I will also write on them my new name. Anyone with ears to hear must listen to the Spirit and understand what he is saying to the churches. So, Easter weekend, 1979, Jackson, Mississippi, which is where I was living as a kid, they experienced the kind of rain for days that we have experienced this morning in Hays County. And because of that, the Pearl River, which is a pretty big river that runs north and south from Mississippi into the Gulf of Mexico, flooded its banks and flooded a good part of Jackson. My grandparents lived in Jackson, and I remember as a kid sitting on the hill between their house and their next door neighbor's house with my sister and my cousins and watching my parents and my aunts and uncles float my grandparents' furniture out of their house. It was crazy. It was so crazy that the road right outside of their house actually was a boat launching ramp. So they had people taking boats around the neighborhood. And so obviously they had to move out of their house for several months, and it had to be completely redone. And one day during the remodel, we were over there at my grandparents' house, and I came up on their bedroom, and the house was empty, and they had this sliding glass door in their bedroom, and it opened out into their back patio. And the back patio was probably about 2 feet below the level of the house. And like any 8-year-old boy, I saw the door was open, and there was a great opportunity to go running through the house, jumping onto the patio. So that's what I did. But the door wasn't open. Now, the good news is the glass door hadn't been installed yet, but there was a screen door that I didn't see, and it was sort of like in the cartoons when you know, and there's like this tray-shaped impression in the screen door, and then I pop the thing off of its tracks, and somehow it lands on top of me as I faceplant onto the patio. I tried to go through a door that was closed because I thought it was open. We do that sometimes, don't we? We try to force our way or force a door open that's actually closed. Several years ago, I came to another door. Before I was in ministry, I was in the cookie business, and Jen and I had a business called Kevin's Cookies. I actually started working there when I was a freshman at UT, and I eventually bought it from my boss, but this is what I did for 21 and a half years. And at this point, I'd come to a door that I wasn't sure was staying open or closing because business had been really tough for a few years. And it seemed like every time we were going to get ahead, we just kept getting knocked behind. And I really was questioning, is God telling me it's time to move on from this? And I didn't want to believe that he was because I didn't know what I was going to do. This is all I'd done since I was 18. So I started praying, and I just said, and I kid you not, my prayer was, Lord, if you are closing this door, make it obvious to me because I'm too stupid and too stubborn to close it myself. But I don't want to miss out on what you really want me to do. Now, that's the prayer I prayed, but what I was hoping was that the door would stay open. God answered my prayer, not the way that I was hoping he would, because that door closed. But he opened another one for me. I think the church in Philadelphia was kind of in this place where they felt a little beaten down. They weren't sure if they were still doing what they were supposed to be doing or not. And Jesus' message to the church is a message of hope and direction. And I think that the message that he has for Philadelphia is a message that he has for the Connection Church. And I think it's a message that he doesn't just have for the Connection Church, but I think it's a message that he has for me and that he has for you. And the first thing that Jesus has to say to the church is this: God notices. Did you catch that part? He said, I see what you're doing. Have you ever had those times where you just think, I don't even know why I try? It seems like everything that I do, just I'm bumping my head up against it, and I'm never getting ahead. And I look around, and I'm doing the right things, and I'm not making progress. And others who aren't taking the same steps that I am, they don't seem to struggle the way I do. Doesn't anybody see what I'm doing? The answer is yes. Somebody does see. God sees. He sees what you're doing. And I want you to remember that we don't do these things so that we can impress our friends on social media. We don't do these things so that we can impress our friends or our family. We live our lives for an audience of one, and that is your Heavenly Father, and He loves you, and He created you for a purpose, and He notices your struggles, and He notices your frustration. Keep that in mind, and keep Him at the forefront of what you're doing. The other thing that jumps out at me in this passage is that Jesus tells the church in Philadelphia that He has opened a door that no one can shut. God has opened a door. I'm going to open this door right now. The thing is that God opens doors that nobody can shut. And as long as we stay behind the door, nothing's going to change. We got to go through the door. And I believe that there are some open doors here at the Connection Church that God wants us to walk through. Easter's in 2 weeks. It's one of the three biggest weekends of the year. And we know that our church is going to be packed full of people. And we know that many of them will be at church for the first time. Many of them may not come back to church ever, or they may not come back to church until Christmas. But it's an open door for us to make sure that they get the life-changing message of Jesus. So there are three doors that I want to talk about today that are open for us as a church that every single one of us can walk through. And the first door is the invite door. I want to read to you from Romans. It's Romans chapter 10, verses 14 and 15. Paul says, "But how can they call on Him to save them unless they believe in Him? And how can they believe in Him if they've never heard about Him? And how can they hear about Him unless someone tells them? And how will anyone go and tell them without being sent?" Did you catch that? How will they hear about Him unless somebody tells them? And I would take that one step further, and I would say, how can anyone tell them if we don't invite them? The invite door is wide open, church. There's so much power in the invitation. We have a community full of thousands of people who don't know that God has created them for a purpose, that He loves them and He wants a relationship with them. And we have an opportunity to tell them that message, but if we don't invite them, they're not just going to sit around and go, "Hey, I don't believe in Jesus. I think I'll go to church today." Invitation is powerful. And I want to challenge every single one of you to invite three people for our Easter services. Get them tickets. Have them join you. But invite them. We don't know what kind of life change God has in store for people who walk through these doors on Easter. But what I do know is that we can't be a part of that if we're not inviting. So make sure you walk through the invite door. The second door is the serve door. We say a lot around staff that we are a family expecting guests. So every Sunday, it's like we're opening our house so that our invited guests can come in. The serve door is all about putting my comfort and my own preferences aside and elevating someone else's comfort level and someone else's preferences. And the reason the serve door is so important is because it gives every single one of us an opportunity to engage in the mission right here at the Connection Church. Hospitality is talked about a lot in the Bible. And hospitality, it means serving. It means making people comfortable. It means being a place where people want to be. And that's what we want the Connection Church to be. We want it to be a place that people feel comfortable. And this is where you guys come in. So what I want to do is I actually want to walk us through what a first-time guest should experience every time they walk through the doors at the Connection Church. And the first people they encounter are our street team. Now, if you are not sure what the street team does, they do more than ride around on a cool golf cart. They're actually the folks, the first folks that you see when you drive into the church parking lot. So let's just say I haven't been to church in 20 years. I left home, decided I didn't need that anymore, don't really think that stuff's important, but somebody invited me to the Connection Church. So I'm going to come because I'd like to get my questions answered. I'm not sure I believe this stuff, but I'll go. So I drive up, and there's this guy right there at the drive-in waving at me and making me feel welcome. Maybe it's a little cheesy, but I already feel better. And then he points to another guy and tells me, go to that guy. And that guy brings me in and points me to somebody else who's standing right by a parking place that he's going to direct me to. Now, I don't know about you, but I don't like to go to sporting events or concerts and things, A, because people scare me, but B, because I'm always thinking about, well, where am I going to park? The traffic's going to be terrible. I'm stressing myself out. And the idea that if I'm going to go to something where I have to worry about this and there's already a team in place to dispel that fear, that's very helpful for somebody like me. So they've given me a parking place. I get up to the front doors, and there are five or six people there with big smiles, shaking my hand, giving me a high five, making me feel welcome. And listen, if you're a front door greeter, you guys, you set the mood and tone for the entire Sunday experience at the Connection Church because you're right there. So when I walk in and I'm getting smiles and handshakes, I'm feeling better about this. And then a lobby greeter comes to me and introduces herself. And then she starts talking to my kids and saying, oh man, you guys are gonna love Connection Kids. It is so cool. It is fun. It's a little bit crazy. You're gonna learn some stuff. You're gonna sing. And then I let it slip. This is our first time here. And she says, well, let me walk you back then. And she walks me back to Connection Kids, and she's explaining to me how Connection Kids is the best place for my kids to be on Sunday. And let me just say this. If your kids are not in Connection Kids, you're cheating them. They are missing out on the best hour of their week because there is a group of about 60 adults back there who are background checked to keep your kids safe and who are trained and passionate about loving on kids and teaching them God's word on a level that they enjoy and that they understand. And so this is what's being told to me as I walk my kids back. And just as an aside, you know that scary hour we just had with all the rain and stuff? We had the kids shelter in place during the worst of that. So when we say that Connection Kids is the safest place in Hayes County, we mean it. We're watching out for them. So this lobby greeter hands me off to a Connection Kids team member. They sign me in. They give me a wristband with a number on it, and they say, if there's any reason that we need you to come back here, we're going to flash that number on the screen so that you'll know that you should come back to Connection Kids. But we want you to feel very good about where your kids are. So come back and let us give you a tour and show you the area. You can meet some of our teachers so that you can get a good idea of what your child is in store for. And I walk back there, and I'm seeing kids and adults interacting together and having fun. And I drop my child off, and then I walk down the hall, and I find donuts and coffee. And I get a few donuts for a friend and fix my coffee. And when I walk through these doors, there are two more people smiling at me, welcoming me. One's handing me a pen. The other is giving me this piece of paper. I'm not really sure what to do with it. I guess I take notes on it. And my plan is to hide in the back of the room. But there's this guy in a blue shirt who is right there shaking my hand and saying, hey, we're so glad you're here today. Are there two of you? Yes, there are. Well, come over here. I've got a spot for you. And they lead me to the middle of the room, and I sit down, and before the band has played a note, before Pastor Cole has come onto the stage, I've met 15 people that I've never met before, and they have made me feel important. They have made me feel like somebody, and they have made me feel comfortable. Now listen, church. The message of Jesus Christ is the most compelling and awesome message in history. But if I've got walls up in my heart because I don't really trust people and I'm not sure about any of this, I'm not prepared to hear that message. And when we walk through the serve door, when you walk through the serve door, you're participating in lowering those walls. The things that you do set up what the band does. Set up what the pastor does. So don't ever, ever think for a minute that what you do here at the Connection Church doesn't matter. Because every single life that has ever been changed here at the Connection Church started in the parking lot. That's you. The serve door is open. And you were created to walk through it. This is the best hour of our week, but if all we do is sit and receive, we're missing out on engaging in what God has created us to do. You don't want to miss that. Now, the third door that I believe is open to us is the giving door. And I know some of you are thinking, yep, he had to go there. I know, but listen, before you completely shut me down, the give door is a next level door. You know what giving does? It breaks the connection between this and this. Because I don't think there is a stronger connection between our heart and our money that exists. This represents my security. It represents my status. And letting go of this is scary. You don't have to agree or disagree because we all know that that's true. It's true for me too. The giving door is important because we are made for more than that. And we talk often about the importance of giving our first to God. And it's not because the church needs your money. It's because God knows that in order for us to engage fully in what he has for us, this connection has to be broken. And we have to understand that what we have has been given to us for a reason. And, you know, I can count on one hand the number of people that I know who don't have financial stress. I know you do. I don't think there's maybe a single person in this room that doesn't think that they could use a little more money. And sometimes we mistake generosity with irresponsibility. Being generous doesn't mean I just dump out my pockets and give a pile of money that I don't have. Being generous means that I'm willing to share what God has given me, and I begin to look for opportunities to do it. See, when you're generous, then you start using your eyes and your ears and your heart and looking for folks who need a little help. I'm going to tell you a little story about my mom and dad, who my whole life, we've never had a lot of money. And since I've been out of the house, money has still always been tight for them. And the last two cars that they got, one my mom bought from her sister for super cheap, and the other one they inherited from my granddad when he stopped driving. But both times, they didn't trade in their current car. They didn't sell it on Craigslist. They gave it away. Now, I can tell you, my mom and dad could have used that money, but they were looking for people who needed a car, and they were generous with what they had because they were paying attention. When you walk through the give door, God gives you some really cool opportunities to be generous. And here's the deal. As much as those cars blessed the people that received them, it made a big impact on my mom and dad. Walking through the gift door isn't just about changing others. It's about changing ourselves. And this Easter, you already heard about it during the hosting time, but this Easter we have an opportunity to walk through the give door and make an even bigger difference in Guatemala than we already are. Now, for the past 4 years, we've been in Aguas Arca, and we're going to continue to support Aguas Arca. And if you were here at Christmas, our Christmas offering was given in order to fund Aguas Arca this year. But we've decided that it's time for us to support another village. And this other village is called Plan de Avila. And so our Easter offering is going to go toward funding Plan de Avila. And what that means is that the kids in that village will get a meal every day. It means that we'll begin to do projects that make that community better. And I'm actually going to show you a couple of pictures, because we went to Plan de Avila last summer. And it's a really big village, and it's on the bank of a river. And in order to get there, you have to cross this bridge. I call it the Bridge of Death because it's really shaky. It's like a rope bridge. I can't remember. I may be exaggerating. Is there a board out here or there? No, that's just me exaggerating. But is it scary? Yeah, it's like 30 feet above the river, you know? And when you get to the other side, this is one part of Plan de Avila called Sector 1. And Sector 1 has a school, and it has a meal plan or a meal program in place already. So what we're going to do is we're going to sponsor Sectors 2 and 3. And Sectors 2 and 3 are up this mountain. They're like, it's like a 45-minute hike up a mountain to get there. And it is remote and desolate and extremely impoverished. The people in Sectors 2 and 3, it's so far away from the school that the kids actually go to school in a different village called El Reparadero. So our feeding program isn't just going to help the kids in Sectors 2 and 3, but it'll be feeding the kids in this other village, El Reparadero, as well. So it's sort of a two-for-one deal. We're going to be feeding kids in two different villages. But these folks, they don't have clean water. In fact, I think I have a picture I want to show you of the water in Plan de Avila. This is well water that they get from a guy. The well is on his property. Speaking of generous, he is not a rich man. He's as poor as them. He just happens to have a well on his property. And he shares the water with the people in Sectors 2 and 3. And it looks like that. And if you think that that water smells bad, it does smell bad. And what they use to purify it is bleach. Everybody in these villages have worms in their intestines. They're sick because this is their drinking water. So one of the things that we're going to do this summer is we're going to take some portable water filtration systems. What we do is we'll drill a hole in the bucket, we'll attach the filter to a hose, and the water comes out on the other side looking like this. Yeah. Now, just a fun aside, nobody would drink that water when we did it until I drank it. Because they'd never seen it before, and they didn't trust us. So once I drank the water, then the people in the houses would drink the water. And there are 64 or 65 households in Sectors 2 and 3. And last summer, we were able to take 20 water filters. And my hope is that this summer, when we go in June, that we'll be able to put these filtration systems in the other 44 households. And the organization we're working with, Hunger Relief International, is going to try to deworm everybody before we get there so that everybody is healthier. And then they can start drinking clean water and we can keep them healthier. That's what happens when you walk through the give door. That's what happens when you walk through the give door. And that's what is happening because you have walked through the give door. So I know it can be scary. I know it can be scary. But I promise you, if you will break the chain between this and this and walk through that give door, God will do some amazing things in your life as well as some amazing world-changing things. church in Philadelphia is pretty similar to us. You read, what does Jesus say? He says, you have little strength. They didn't think they could do much. And I think that there are a lot of us in this room who think, I can't really do much. I don't have a lot. I'm not that smart, maybe. I'm not that talented. But here's the deal. You don't need to be. You need to give God what you have. You need to give God who you are and let him do his thing with your obedience. And that's what Jesus told the church in Philadelphia. He said, hold on. Hold on to what you have and watch what I'll do with it. And I think that's what he's saying to the Connection Church today. Hold on. Keep doing those right things. Galatians 6:9 says, I can't remember what it says. So I'm going to cheat and I'm going to look. It says, let us not become weary in doing good, for at the proper time we will reap a harvest. We don't know when that's going to be. But if we keep doing those right things, if we keep walking through those doors that God is opening for us, then we will reap a harvest. You know, we found some more leaks in the roof this morning. It's probably going to smell a little funky in here by Wednesday because of water seeping into the insulation. This is not the prettiest concrete floor I've ever seen, and there are some holes in the walls in Connection Kids for some strange reason. If we look, we can find all sorts of reasons why the Connection Church is not enough. But as long as we keep doing those right things and keep our eyes focused on God and keep walking through those doors that he opens for us, that no person can close, it doesn't matter how nice or crummy our church building is. I kind of like it. I think it gives us character. Because I know what happens inside these walls. And you get a piece of that ownership when you walk through those doors. Don't miss it. Now, some of you might be here today and you think, well, you know, how do I do that? How do I do it? What do I do? Well, the thing to do is you just say yes. You don't have to have the plan right now. Just say yes. If you've never invited somebody to the Connection Church, say yes and invite somebody for Easter. If you haven't joined the Dream Team yet, say yes and go out and sign up over here at the Dream Team Center to your right and be a part of actively changing lives. If you haven't given before or you're just kind of giving a little bit here and there, say yes. Walk through that door and watch what God does in your life, as well as what God does with what you say yes to. Because our yes is more powerful than $1 million. It's more powerful than anything, because God is in that yes. When you say yes to him, big things start to happen. Don't miss it. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, thank you so much, Lord, for the doors that you open, even when we don't see them. Lord, we know that you have opened some doors for us as a church. You've opened some doors for us as individuals. And I pray that you would give us eyes to see those open doors, that you would give us hearts to be tuned in to what you want us to do, that you'd give us ears to hear where you want us to go. Lord, we want our lives to be significant. We know that you did not create us on accident. You created us on purpose, and we want to be fully engaged in that purpose you have for us. And I pray, Lord, that those folks in Hayes County who don't know how much you love them would be drawn to the Connection Church so that they could find out that you created them for a purpose, that you love them, and that you want a relationship with them. Lord, thank you that our own imperfections and sin that keep us from you didn't create a door to be closed forever. Thank you for sending Jesus to open that door between life and death, to be the perfect one to die in our place so that we could walk through the door into eternity with you. Lord, thank you for forgiving us for those sins. And Lord, if there's anyone here today who hasn't walked through that door before, then I just pray that you would lead them through today. Lord, that they would know that eternal life is available to them because that's how much you love them. And if that's you today and you're ready to walk through that door, then we can do that right now. Because the Bible says, when we confess with our mouth and we believe in our hearts, then we'll be saved. When we confess that Jesus is the leader of our life, that he died for our sins and he came back from the dead because he was the Son of God and had the power to do it. When we believe that and we confess it, we make that choice to step through the door into eternity. And if that's you, then let's pray together right now. Lord, thank you so much for your goodness. I know that I can't walk through the door to eternal life without your help. And I thank you for sending your son, Jesus, to do that, to die in my place so that I could be a part of your family forever. Thank you for saving me. Today, I choose to make him the leader of my life. And I don't even know all of what that means, but I know that this is my first step. And I want to have life change in my own life. Thank you for saving me. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Join us this week at 7 p.m. for First Wednesday. We'll experience the sound of music, the celebration of communion, and the power of prayer. It's the perfect way to start a new month. Easter weekend is on its way. Here's what you need to know. We are partnering with the City of Buda for a free community Easter egg hunt on Saturday, April 15th from 9 a.m. to noon. The hunt begins promptly at 9:30 a.m., but you can volunteer in a two-hour time slot from 8 to 10 a.m. or 10 a.m. to noon. The Connection Church provides plenty of happy faces, many helping hands, and tons of candy. Sign up to volunteer and bring your candy to the Easter booth in the lobby. Mark your calendars for our Easter service times, Saturday, April 15th at 5:30 p.m. and Sunday, April 16th at 9 a.m., 10:30 a.m. and noon. Pick up your free tickets and yard signs at Easter Central in the lobby today or by visiting ConnectionEaster.com.
Girl Time happens April 10th at 7 p.m., where women connect with God and each other. Child care is free when you RSVP to Sandy at theconnectionchurch.org by April 9th.
We're so glad you joined us today. If it's your first time, you're our VIP. Visit the red carpet in the lobby for a special gift that's just for you.
We hope you enjoyed this video resource from The Connection Church, and we want to get connected with you. Visit theconnectionchurch.org for more information.